course, we won't have a call.
Well, everybody, if you see our smiling faces, it must be that time. It's time for Let's Talk Racing. Something new. Al would appreciate that.
Yeah, well, we figured you would have to be smiling after this week's race.
Yeah.
With your man, I see even the 14 car has now moved to the center stage there.
Yeah, there you go. That's what we got. So what'd y'all think about Denny doing that mirror driving just way too long?
I think if you're going to knock Tony Stewart out of the way, which you should do in order to get the win, but just don't let him get back to you because, you know, it's coming back. But Denny was saying, you know, that he messed up and left that bottom open and let Tony get beside him. So, you know, I mean, whether it was Denny's, mistake or Tony's mistake that Denny caught up to him, either way, Tony made sure he wasn't going to be in any shape to pass him again.
Bounce his ass on the wall.
Yeah.
But, you can see when Denny goes down there, being a driver and understanding mirror driving, if you concentrate too much on that mirror, you're not watching far enough in front of you.
Yep.
And then all of a sudden, he's shooting down. You see him locking up the tires, trying to get that turn in. But once you lock them, you're sliding. You ain't turning. So at that point, Tony says, gotcha.
Yeah.
Cha-ching.
Cha-ching. Or as Sheldon would say, bazinga.
Yeah.
For those of y'all, that's Big Bang Theory. Mm-hmm. But it would be neat to have those guys put together a race car and put.
What's which one?
The Big Bang Theory guys.
To have them put a car together.
Set up a car.
Right, you know that's a TV show, right?
That's correct.
They're not necessarily as smart as the nerds.
But I'm just saying.
They play on TV.
I'm just saying. There's actually, believe it or not, some people I'm working with were actually trying to make them do one 30-minute segment of where we have her come to become part of a race driving team.
Okay.
And they're going to be like her crew.
Okay.
So
that'd be interesting.
If this comes to fruition, it ought to be awesome.
Yeah. Can't be any worse than the Duck Dynasty people.
No. No, but they wouldn't try to put a car out there themselves, that's for sure. They just like to pay for the race.
Well, they got the engineer and all the, you know, by the TV show, you got the engineer and all this other stuff and all these high IQ guys, they should be able to really think something up good.
Yeah, but look at the salaries. I mean, their salary would for the show for that 1 week would pay for the car for the year.
Yeah.
But
they would have to do an electric car, though, I'm sure. Because I'm sure that show leans towards earth-friendly, whatever. I'm sure.
Yeah, but you saw that little 3D printed car that my son did, the Cobra Mustang, that's all electric.
Yeah.
At Oak Ridge.
Yeah, but I'm talking about for NASCAR and for what you call it.
Anyway, that's a future thing. That's a future thing behind the scenes. Enough said. As we move on. And then Tony's new hero is John West Townley.
Yep.
That's right, I forgot. You haven't watched the media interview. It is freaking hilarious, the interview after Tony won the Sonoma race.
But I think the best part when he said, you said the F word, he's like, oh, I said the F word. He's like, oh no, which one did I say?
It was fun.
Fun
was the F word.
Okay.
Because Tony said he wanted to be racing stuff that was fun. So when you're winning, it's fun, okay?
One thing about it, when Tony climbed out of the car, when they were showing him do the PR interview, he was definitely worn out.
Oh,
definitely
yeah.
Out of shape.
Yeah, but it was cute.
He
says, wow, he says, I've almost made the whole race without getting fined.
Yeah.
Oh, you have to watch the interview. It is almost 50 minutes long. Okay, that's included.
He's talking about Boyer, seeing how they
he's probably just glad to be talking about something with a good finish and all that and not having people trying to negatively spin stuff against him here over the past, you know, 2 or 3 years.
Yeah, and I texted William Byron when he said, you know, oh man, Tony's talking about you. He goes, what? I said, I'll send you the link when I put it on YouTube. So he thought that was really awesome. He says, yeah, this guy, William Byron, who ever heard of William Byron? All of a sudden, he's won 2 truck races, you know, back to back. Holy crap, you know? Mm-hmm. Not really holy crap, but, you know, basically.
I should have had him on tonight.
I probably could have, but I already had pretty much everybody already set, except for Cody, and then that last minute thing got changed.
Well, it did end up being 3 in a row for Kyle Busch Racing or Kyle Busch Motorsports or whatever it is. So,
but Tony tweeted also about John West Townley too. So said finally somebody's got some balls to go do something.
Finally, somebody else is getting fined besides me.
Yeah, they both got fined. I think John West Townley got fined $15,000, and Spencer got only fined about 12.5.
Only.
I think it was.
Only.
Well, again, I don't know. I mean, you said this, so I didn't see the whole race, so I don't know. You know exactly what led up to. Was he had he wrecked him another race before this?
No. It was three altercations in the same race.
Okay, so each time he's trying to put him in the wall.
The first time it was kind of sort of an accident, and unless somebody had a camera on John West Townley, did he do some retribution back to Spencer, and then Spencer got pissed and knocked him in the wall.
Third time's a charm.
And then the third time, toward the end of the race, Spencer got him into the wall again. Both trucks were really heavy damaged. I think the reason John West got the bigger fine because he did come down to Spencer's truck to punch him out. He didn't waste no time. Mm-hmm. And there was into WWE at that point.
And of course, the officials didn't do anything either.
That's something that NASCAR needs to explain.
There was no officials near there.
Oh, no.
Well, there were safety trucks already there.
The safety trucks were there.
Okay, well.
But they're not.
Okay. Well, they may not be wearing the white suit that says official on the back.
But
to me, if you're going to have. If he. Action between two drivers gets to that point. Somebody needs to step in, or they need to have an official ride on every safety truck that can step in.
But if you notice, when it first happens, and he gets out of the truck, he starts sort of walking down towards Spencer's side, and you notice that it seems like everybody's looking at the trucks and not watching them.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, they're into it. It's that quick. It's just like, as if he walked over to you and all of a sudden decided to be gnarly with you.
Well, no, okay, so if he was dead set on taking him out, then why doesn't, okay, he got a $12,000 fine, why doesn't the Matt Kenseth rule come into play? Matt Kenseth basically, and I'm not defending Matt Kenseth, not that I'm a fan or anything of Matt Kenseth, but, last year, NASCAR's lack of action against Logano led to Kenseth taking matters into his own hands. Well, if Gallagher's out there, intentionally trying to wreck John Rex weekly multiple times.
It's making up for the ones that didn't.
Yeah, so.
Yeah.
I don't know.
The sad part is you don't have somebody with a camera that was watching him the whole time.
Yeah.
And that would be the tell-all at that point. You know, were they bouncing and beating on each other, on the restarts and everything? Because I know John West had to be way down after the second altercation, because they had to go work on the back end of that truck.
Well, if the guy's beating up his equipment the whole race, I don't blame him from trying to punch him out. But, again, there was a lot of mistakes NASCAR probably made in that situation. Again, they may not need to start having an official ride on every safety truck, so in case there's an altercation between drivers, somebody's responsible. And if you look at what Townley did, I mean, he tries a double WWE move.
He tried to pound
a dude's head into the asphalt. Now, let's just say Gallagher is knocked out cold at that point. What happens then?
Then you have legal.
Then now NASCAR put no one out there to stop the fight. And it went to that point. Now this dude has been knocked out cold on the racetrack by having his head crammed into the asphalt. Then what are you going to do? Are you going to take John West Townley out of the car for the rest of the year?
Well, actually,
for intentionally trying to kill somebody or what?
Well, actually, it was like the other way around. John West tried to get his leg around Spencer to flop him down, worked against him, and they wound up, John West was on the bottom, landed on his back.
I think they ought to make it mandatory that the two of them have to get in the ring before the next fight. I mean, before the next race. Get in the ring and
not get in the ring. Like I said, get the sumo suits.
No,
because sumo suits, you aren't going to get hurt.
Yeah, well, they can put them in a real.
Wear your ass out.
Put them in one of those face bounce things with the big oversized gloves and let them just beat the crap.
That'll work, Jake.
Put them in the octagon.
Now those boys were tired by the end of that race because you saw. Mm-hmm. I mean, even John was really hardly throwing a punch.
At the end they couldn't really get off anything good.
That was just like a quick 2 seconds worth of steam, and then it kind of went away after that.
Yeah,
I mean, I'm all for fighting after the race, but. I guess it just seemed, it was just an odd situation, so. Anyway. I just thought it was weird to see him mixing it up that long and not doing any damage other than the guy almost got his head run into the asphalt, and no one shows up to, you know, do anything to try to stop her.
Somebody,
they just said, screw it, no one's coming over here to save us from ourselves, so let's just quit fighting.
Yeah, I know. We'll just get tired. And
yeah, Spencer around. Kept grabbing John's arm, and I just, fell with it. But, I don't know. I was half tempted to do a few texting to somebody, like, as in two of them. But I just, we'll stay away. There's going to be enough stuff coming down.
There were some good parodies online. Colin was showing me one this morning with the announcer from WWE. What's it called?
John Wood or something like that?
John Wood, is that his name?
Something like that.
The guy that kind of has half his face is about half asleep.
It's on Fox.
But
that's so fun.
The announcers, they were doing points for takedowns and for punches thrown.
Yeah.
And they gave it to John West 8-2. The 2 points Spencer got was the takedown when Don was trying to get his leg behind his and trip him.
But anyway,
just throw some punches.
They get paid to drive, not fight, and that's pretty obvious.
Yeah. if you're gonna throw some punches, throw punches.
Stand up there and fight. Come on, what's all this hugging and kissing stuff? I mean, why don't they stand up there? Who told them to start wrestling?
Now you know what's really, and this is a morbid sense of view here. When I was looking at those guys, it was almost like it was staged, because John never really actually hit anything. It was like
swinging over his head,
you know, and he was.
Oh, he got him a couple in the he got his arm loose a couple times. But it wasn't. It was kind of glancing blows, but
it didn't look like it was that hard. I mean, I know how to pull a punch when I throw punches, and so what's to say that this wasn't a nice little thing? And NASCAR's probably gonna pay their fines.
And Colin was saying too. So, how many weeks go by before they start using that for the promotion for the next truck race? So
yeah.
I mean, I know the fines. I assume the fines go to charity or whatever.
They're supposed to go to the NASCAR Foundation.
I guess they got to have something to add to the pot.
Gotta have something.
Maybe the Cup guys haven't put enough money in there yet this year.
it's amazing how many charities, when you donate to one, they send money to another. That this charity, you know, and what gets me is like, so-and-so charity, oh, they donated $1 million to this charity. Well, somebody donated $1 million to them first. So it makes it sound like, oh, we're giving you $1 million. Well, somebody just passed the hat off, basically. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But, anywho.
So, now the next question is, with Tony winning the race, can they put together enough finishes to make sure they get in the top 30 solidly?
He's not like be 9 points out. So.
Okay, well, that could be 9 points out, or it could be 25 after this coming race, or it could be...
Counting this weekend to Richmond, counting Richmond, is 10 races.
Yeah.
So you've got 9 till Richmond.
And so Richmond, you can't go messing up. You can't have a big wreck at Daytona and, you know, finish...
So what are you going to do, right at the back end all?
I don't know, but I mean, you can't finish 38th at Daytona and then have a blown motor or something else, and all of a sudden you're digging back out of the hole again.
Well,
you'd have to win another race.
The cure for the Daytona race is lead the whole damn thing and win it.
Avoid the big one?
No. He needs to get solidly ahead of the, like, 25th through 30th place so that there's no way he can fall out no matter what happens. Somehow he needs to...
Because on the Sprint app, it says that he's 32nd in points.
Okay. So
but to get in the chase,
I'd hate for him to win
happen.
That race and then not be able to get in the chase because something happens and he doesn't stay in the top 30.
He's got the one win, but he needs to be 30th or better in points.
That's right. So if something happens by, you said, 10 races from now...
That's counting Richmond.
And he's still on the fence, you know, one way or the other, anything could happen.
But still, you look at the couple that are ahead of him, and you would theoretically think that he's better than them. But still, like you said, one bad wreck, one bad race could really widen the gap.
And theoretically, you would think that all the Stewart Haas cars would run as good as Harvick and Kurt Busch, but they haven't been over the last 2 or 3 years, so I don't know. I guess we'll see. Tony usually, he carries some momentum into the hotter months, so maybe...
Yep. That's one of the things we were talking about at the interview was, you know, hey, it's been known that when the months start getting hot, you do too. And got this roll going on. What do you think? Is that on 809?
It is, yes. Should I use the other one?
No, that's fine. 809 is fine.
In order to call...
Oh, boy. Redo.
Yeah, redo.
Sean.
This is Sean at Signs and Graphics to Go. Sorry I'm not available. Okay.
Texting him now.
Do what?
I'm texting him.
Yes.
Well, I didn't recognize the number, so I didn't answer. I didn't realize what time it was. I was on the other line.
Well, he did tell me he's going to be traveling, or he'll be out of town. Call me. Got the phone.
So, with his new series, where all is he racing, obviously, since he's not at Langley?
Do what now?
With his new series.
He's going to run Southern Modified. That's a NASCAR sanctioned
touring division. But as far as tracks, where do they rotate?
I think he's going to South Boston for this one.
I mean, cause I know some of them, say like the K&N East and West, I know different ones, you travel different circles, or it could just be Virginia, or it could be just North Carolina, so I didn't know.
Oh, let's see, Southern Modified Series races, I think, from like D.C. on down.
Probably D.C. to South Carolina, maybe?
No, I mean, further down than that.
Really? To Florida?
They do some traveling, they're just like a little K&N, but running modifieds. Let's see if I can pull that up for you.
And then you got the Northern Modified Tour as well.
So the next question would be, I have to figure out that one. How many modified series are there?
Let's talk racing.
Hey!
Hey!
Hey who?
Hey who?
Hey guys!
I hope this is Sean.
Yes, I'm right smack in the middle of finishing Maddie. What's her name?
Maddie Ryan.
Joking? Yes, I was joking. Maddie Ryan, sorry.
I thought you were going to be out of town.
I am. I'm heading up there as soon as I'm done with this. We ran into a little situation that slowed us up a little bit.
Oh, okay.
But the moment I'm done with this, I'm gone.
So tell us, you're now going to be running the Southern Modified Touring Series, right?
Yeah, we've got a little bit left to nail down, which we're going to do this weekend at Caraway. But that's the plan right now. We need to nail down a little bit of sponsorship and see who we can con to get on board this thing. But other than that, that's the plan.
Well, tell us how that came to happen.
Say again?
Tell us how it came about to running Southern Modifier versus the other series.
Oh, Jeremy and Gister had known me from Langley, or seen me at Langley, and he was looking for just somebody to pilot a car. But, I mean, there's no real big thing to it. It just came about. Just some talking, and like I said, we need to nail down a few things yet, but it's pretty exciting. We'll see what happens. The exciting part, I guess, or most exciting part, I guess, would be East Carolina and being able to race it there. Miss running down there in modified, any modified, because you're not running the modifieds down there at all.
Yeah. Now, your first
story here is just we're going to go and have a good time.
So when's your first race?
We're hoping that it will be both ways. And again, right at the moment, it's probably hinging a little bit on sponsorship, but I think we'll get there. I think that everything will work out good. But we're looking at Bowman Gray, and I think South Boston's after that, and then East Carolina, and then South Boston.
All right, so you're not going to go to Bristol?
Definitely not going to Bristol. You know, obviously, I've never raced Southern Mod before, so I got to do some. I got to do some learning. I'm trying to do something on top again. I'm sorry, I'm distracted. Maddie's car has to leave here shortly, and I'm actually doing the wrapping myself this time, just so we can get it done.
How
and my hands full.
How different are the Southern Modifieds from the Weekly Series Modified cars?
The biggest difference, obviously, as anybody's seen them, is the size of the tires, which are gigantic. 15-inch tires as opposed to 8-inch tires. With not a lot of difference in horsepower. My understanding is the Southern Mods have about 700 horsepower as opposed to our 550, 600, depending on your engine builder and what the weight says. not a huge difference there, but the difference is the tires. The Collin Brown's obviously stick a whole lot better than our car. And I don't know exactly. I have to find out, obviously. But they seem to seem to have softer tires also, and I'm not sure about that, but I believe they have softer tires, which are going to wear out much quicker. So you have to, in both cars, you have to be aware of tire wear, and monitor the tire wear, pay attention to your tire wear. Other than that, I think that the cockpits are very similar. Of course, I didn't say that yet. When I drove Jason Myers back at Langley, it was just for a few laps and a little bit of practice. And this car should be very similar to that. So it's a should be a very similar animal in some aspects. In other aspects, it would be much different. The dealing with NASCAR is much different. You have to go through a little bit of a process, not much, but a little bit of a process to get approved to drive. They don't, you know, they don't have the championship drive. They want to. Do a little research on you first. Brett Bodine handled that. He took care of that for me today. And yeah, that's about where we're at. I'm excited about it, but on the same hand, just a little bit apprehensive right at the moment. So we have everything nailed down. We thought we had just everything nailed down, and just you know, this is a lot bigger deal than to me than. You know, just putting our car together for Langley. There's a lot of working and moving pieces and a lot of people involved in it. So that's where we're at right now.
Do y'all carry a backup car as well?
Oh, no. We are the backup car. just don't wreck this one. That's the whole deal. No, we're never teammates or nothing like that, so we never carry a backup car. Now, if we were racing points or, you know, this progressed a year or two down the road, that would be a different story. And some of the guys bring backup cars, some of the guys do not bring backup cars. I heard that when we came to Langley and I drove Myers' car, that was their backup car. So, and they were chasing points, everybody's chasing points like they always are, and that was one as big a field as they could get. So that's what that came about.
Now,
but other than that, go ahead.
Oh, go ahead. Finish up what your thought was.
I thought forgot. I'm sorry to sound so distraught, but I am supposed to be running down from here on the road, and I'm supposed to sit here trying to get this done. You know how it is. You got priorities and race cars. And you know what you're doing, the race car comes first, and you got to get it done. Especially when you're in business and you're trying to take care of somebody, you have to get it finished for them so they can race.
Yeah. Where's Maddie going?
Maddie is going to Boston Test Tomorrow, and she had a very blank race car. you know, hers was pretty extravagant looking, so I had to get.
Now, you said you talked to Bodine. Now, I mean...
Say again?
I said you said you talked to Bodine. Now, for your classifications about where you can go to. Shawn, you've been racing freaking forever, okay? You've won multitude of championships. I mean, they'd probably authorize you for 5-mile track if they had one.
I think that I wouldn't have any trouble getting authorized for racetrack. I'm pretty positive of that. The problem is just having taking too big a chance to go to Bristol. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, because I think you got both the Southern Modified and the regular Wheeling Modifieds are going to be racing there that same day.
Oh, yes. It's a combo race, yes. And that's the other thing, too. It would be very icky if we could even make the show there. You have the Northern Modifiers, which are the regular Wheeling Modifiers. Well, they're identical cars. It's just a different group of guys. But the Northern guys seem to dominate that race pretty much every year, from what I've seen. The Southern boys struggle to keep up with the Northern boys. And because I haven't been around the series enough, I don't really understand why there would be a discrepancy like that. But there is. It seems to be track time, maybe. I don't know. Maybe the Northern guys are on those type of tracks like Bristol. They're very high bank, very fast tracks up north. There's more racing up north. I mean, the Southern Modified only race. I don't know. Team races? Not even that. 12 races, and the Northern guys are racing 5 times a week.
Yeah, these.
So there may be that disparity.
Yeah, they've, what have they got? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Looks like you got like 11 races you guys run, and it looks like they've got like 18 races they run up north.
Yeah, they race, they also, and just like down here, Bowman Racehorses are the same as the Southern Tour races. But up there, there's a bunch of tracks that run the same type of car.
Cool.
You know what I mean?
Have you been Bowman Gray yet?
I've seen it. I've been there. Of course, I've seen it on TV. But I also seen it. I've also been there and watched some really crazy races. I haven't seen a Southern Tour race, which is more regulated by NASCAR. And I don't know if there are any classic sightings. There's the regular modifier there. Same car.
Appreciating
a different tactic, I guess.
Okay. Hey, Sean.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
I tell you what, we're going to let you get back to wrapping the car.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm sure, like you said, I understand all of that stuff. You got some stuff you're doing on. So, in that case, that means you owe us to come in after you've been to Bowman Gray to let us know how everything went.
Yep, I'll let you know if there's any issues with getting the deal all together, which I don't really expect, but there's just a couple things we got to get ironed out. And then probably have a little bit more excitement about it once it's finalized.
All right.
So, we'll see.
Thanks.
I appreciate it, guys.
No problem. Good. Do it quick.
Keep up with you and let you know how things are going. And then get on here yelling and screaming after going to break. Actually, to tell you the truth, like I said, East Carolina is what I'm really excited about because, you know, none of the Southern Modified guys have ever been there. Not, I don't think any of them. And, of course, I've been there once or twice.
Cool. All right, thank you, sponsors, and go ahead and thank your sponsors and get the hell off the phone.
I have none. We need sponsors. Call me. Anybody's out there. I never have really looked for sponsors before, so I don't really know what to do. But if anybody wants to get on the car, we got three quarter pins. Or two quarter pins to get on. So, and three of the races, if we make all three, and the dealer goes on, and we run all the races we'd like to run, three of them are TV races. I think you would know more than me, Roger, on that, but I believe three of them are TV races.
Cool. What else? Since you're telling you need them, how much are you charging for the quarter panels?
Say that again?
What are you charging for the quarter panels? So if you're already telling people...
Oh, they have to call me and we'd have to talk about it.
Okay, then.
If Bill Gates calls me, give him a deal of about 20 grand a quarter panel a race.
Okay.
And if Bill Gloves Tire Place calls me, we'll make
it 20 minutes or so, I guess.
All right, Sean.
Thanks so much, Ryan. Guys. I appreciate it.
All right, talk to you later, Sean.
All right.
Bye. You know, you can sit there just listening to his tone change, and he's trying to wrap the car and keep his phone.
Sounds like he's losing grip on his
shoulder.
Yeah. Sounds like his phone's slipping.
Yeah.
Hey, Ryan, how you doing?
Good. How are you guys?
We're having fun. We get to talk about racing. You got a little bit more fun. You get to go do it.
Oh yeah, I can't wait.
So go ahead and give everybody a quick rundown about yourself.
Okay, I'm 26 years old, been racing for 22 years now, and been racing at the top levels of NASCAR for just 3 or 4 years. Made my Sprint Cup debut last year, and I'm kind of part-time in Xfinity and truck right now, so trying to find more rides, but, you know, it's always hard. You always got to find money, and money buys opportunity, so doing all I can.
Good deal. Now, there's a lot of stuff going on now. Like you said, you've got your new ride starting up here, and then you also got this thing going on with the new NASCAR racing game coming up.
Yeah, so we actually found out about that at least about a month or two ago, and you know, that's really big for a small team, a small sponsor with Science Logic out there. I know they're very excited. We're only running, as far as we know, three races for the year, including the Richmond, the race we already ran. So it's pretty cool for someone, you know, that's only running part-time to be in the video game. And obviously Toyota has a big part in that. And with us running a Toyota car, I think it definitely helps us get in the game. But obviously for me, that's so cool. I always wanted to be in a video game. So it's cool for me. It's awesome for the sponsor. And he comes out in September, so I can't wait to get it.
Cool.
Now, are you going to run in Richmond again this September?
No, I wish we were, but I think they've kind of met their demographic for that area already as far as their potential vendors go. So,
okay, what about Xfinity then? Even if you don't do the Cup for Richmond, are you going to run Xfinity in Richmond maybe?
Yeah, I mean, for the Xfinity stuff, a lot of it is time I'm hired when other people don't have money, so... If I'm not in it, meet someone, I guess, usually had money or something didn't work out. So I literally find out week to week, usually 2 or 3 days before the race. But I hope so. I love Richmond.
Well, everybody wants you back at our tailgate party. They're still talking about that. It was so funny that one time when you came out and hung out with Christina and my son and all of us, and the people next to us, they kept looking over at you. I said, it's a real Cup driver. And they're like, no way. And they kept staring at you around the car.
Oh, yeah. It's fun to be able to go out and do that kind of stuff. I know, like, obviously I'm not a big enough name or face right now to really fight the problem side of that, but, like, to go out and just network with fans. And I had a friend in town yesterday, and we went to Joe Gibbs' headquarters and just showing him what other teams are like. And, you know, the receptionist, no one really knows. And it's like, oh, you in town for the races or this, that? And they're like, oh, yeah, you know, I'm just visiting. Figuring out
what I'll have to tell you sometime when I get a chance to ask me about the Timothy Peters story.
Oh, okay. Well.
And I'll have to relate to you because you're sitting there saying about how not many people know you yet. So.
Yeah, it's like I said, it's got its positives and its negatives. You're able to do a lot more than I'm sure.
Think of all the people that you went out and shook hands with and met at all these little tailgate parties that all of a sudden see your name, and then in September when the game comes out, I remember meeting him.
Yeah, no, it's good to network, and then people feel like they have that personal relationship with you, because they're more likely to know you, because especially when you're part-time, it's hard to make a name for yourself. You really end up doing it a lot off track, and whether it's social media or in person, it goes a long way.
Roger.
Trying to tell Mary to speak up a little bit. She's acting like just she's whispering to Ryan over there, and I'm sitting there
having to say
watching the volume meters and saying, "Okay, see if anybody else hears that one."
Do you use iRacing to help you prepare for the upcoming races?
Yeah, I actually just got my simulator updated last night with Carolina Simworks. Came over, there until about almost 1 in the morning, putting it together. There's certain tracks where I think it benefits you a little bit more than others. Obviously, with the rule package almost changing and tires almost changing. But I think it's hard to get perfect. So I get on there a lot, mainly because it's fun. You know, at the end of the day, like, we love racing and we'll race lawnmowers, go-karts, bicycles, anything. So it's just fun to go on there and race with fans and race with other drivers. It's a lot cheaper than real racing, so it's a good way to get laps in.
Well, tell us about the Carolina Sims. Tell us what they did for you, because I showed Roger and the others, or where it was online, something about them.
I have a relationship with a company that builds, like, the base setup for the chair and the mount the steering wheel pedals on, and I was just kind of looking for a way to make it a little better than just a 25 or a 42-inch screen sitting in front of you. So he came in and built me a way better computer that could actually support a three-screen setup, and built me a monitor stand that had a three-screen setup, so you feel like you're really in the race car and you get a peripheral vision. So it was really cool. I mean, I was only able to run a few laps on it before I went to sleep last night, but I think it'll go a long way in preparing for more races and stuff, and just overall more fun. You know, at the end of the day, it's tax deductible because it's trading, so I was like, well, if I'm going to lose the money, the government might as well spend it on a racing simulator and get some fun out of it.
Hey, next time you need one, let me know, because we build some kick-ass computers here.
Oh, really? I don't understand anything IT-related, so I just was like, oh, cool, new computer.
I just finished building one the other day. It takes a whole 5 seconds to boot.
Oh, really?
Yep.
Wow.
And talk about some gaming capabilities.
Next time.
I've got a couple of them that'll handle 4 screens even.
Really?
Yeah.
Wow. Well, I'll hit you up if I ever need another one. Fortunately, I'm just still recovering from this one.
We want people to spend tax deductions.
Yeah, exactly.
Anywho.
Tell me here. I guess work in the industry.
Oh.
Go ahead, your next question.
Ask him about the Redskin thing.
So with you being from Ashburn, Virginia, does that make you a Redskin fan?
I'd say so. I mean, I definitely follow the Redskins. It's hard to be any Washington sports fan, you know. It's like heartbreak every year. I've been following the Packers my whole life, but I definitely follow the Redskins quite a bit. I'd say they're my second team.
Hey, I got a question, Ryan. Did Al Pearce ever get up with you? I know you've been on here a couple of times and had Al Pearce in the house here with us.
Did he ever get up to me?
Al Pearce with Autoweek.
I can't remember. I've done so much stuff over like the last year. I might have. I'm not even sure anymore.
See, you are popular.
Yeah, I mean, the phone rings a lot. It's just not a lot of money coming in for sponsorship. It's definitely tough. And, you know, my team, my group of people and my friends, we work harder than I think any other group out there. So we're definitely always on the phone, and it's just hard to remember who I talk to and when.
Now, with the racing sim stuff, how much information do you go to some of your connections as far as crew guys or crew chiefs for setups?
On, like, in real life or in the simulator?
Simulator.
Oh, in the simulator. Oh, I literally just hop on, download basic setup, and I try to use that as a tool to learn setups myself so that I'm more useful inside the car. So I actually try not to rely on anybody and just make a change and see what it does to the car. And I think I've honestly learned more through iRacing than I ever have in real life, because in real life, we always have to crush and bleed on someone who's an engineer who's done it for years. And it's so nice to be able to just go and make a change. If it sucks, you don't, you know, you're not slow, you don't wreck the car, no one's mad at you. You're just trying something new, and you get that direct connection of making a change that doesn't take 20 minutes off the track, and you're able to make it in 2 seconds and click a button, and all of a sudden have a whole different car. So it's really cool, and it's taught me so much to just kind of mess around with myself.
Have you been cursed out by a 12-year-old on iRacing yet?
Yeah, probably 100 of them. I'm the one that gets in the room, and I did it last night. I wasn't used to the three-screen setup. I just came up right in front of someone, wrecked everybody, and just was like, all right, screw it, and I left the room, and like, they're going to kick me out anyhow, so might as well just knock myself out of the room.
So I'm sitting here looking at your picture on your iRacing simulator. That looks pretty sweet. Do you get do they give you the feedback stuff too as well on there?
The feedback?
Yeah.
No, I don't have any of that, unfortunately.
Oh. So when you bounce into somebody, you don't feel nothing, huh?
No. I drive, you know, that's why I'm pretty much wrecking people every single time I'm in the car, I guess.
Not worried about safety rating?
I'm a real racer than I am my racer.
I said, not worried about the safety rating, huh?
Oh, man, I honestly don't even do the approved races or whatever, the official races, because I only do hosted races. And it's just more of, like, I like being able to just enjoy it and not be worried about, you know, leaning on someone or anything like that. I enjoy just hopping in someone's hosted session and making laps, and if I get bored of it, hopping out. Like, I don't like treating it 100% like it's, you know, another race that we're doing that weekend. So I definitely don't even mess with the safety rating, because mine would be so low.
Would it be of any value to wear your helmet while you're doing the sim racing? Now, I say that just because you're trying to simulate the same view you'd have in the car, you know? I don't know.
No, I literally just have a drink sitting there and just hang out and enjoy it.
Oh, goodness. Well, hey, now, did you watch any of the racing this past weekend?
Oh, at Sonoma, yeah. It was a pretty phenomenal race all the way through. It was cool, obviously. I mean, I was rooting for Cody. I'm pretty sure a lot of people were, but it was really cool just to see him legitimately running up front. He might not have been the fastest car, but he was definitely a top three, top five car. And, you know, to see him pull off that win, was huge for everybody in the sport. You know, I mean, I think there were a lot of people on his side, obviously his teammates and fans, but just people like me that have been kind of looking up to him their whole life, and were able to see him come out and obviously have the struggles he's had and then come right back and succeed. That was cool. That was about as cool of a story as you'll ever see. To me, that was cooler than Jeff Gordon winning Martinsville.
Yeah. Now, I've driven before, you drive now. Thinking back and listening to Denny, you know, talking about, you know, and naturally, you know about mirror driving and how bad that can get you into trouble. And to me, that's what it looked like that Denny did. He was too much mirror driving, not keeping an eye on his marks. And all of a sudden, oh my gosh, got to hit the brakes. Oh, now we've done locked him, we're sliding, and Tony's underneath, and then the rest is history.
Yeah, I think, you know, he was just like anybody else, but you passed Tony Stewart and he was like, wow, okay, I just killed the biggest story in NASCAR. And I'm sure he, you know, he had two or three corners of a really short session or section to kind of really not finish the run out. And I'm sure there were a million things going through his head. And obviously one of them is Tony Stewart is breathing down my neck now. And he said, all right, just got to outbreak this corner so he can't hit me. And I think he was going to drive it deeper so that Tony didn't just kill him, you know, because a lot of people knew that Tony was going to drive in deep and try to move Denny, so he drove it in even harder. He was like, I need to beat him to the corner, I need to get through the corner faster than him so he doesn't move me. And he just overdrove it and wheel hopped it.
Yeah.
I agree with Jeff and a couple other guys that he wheel hopped, and I know Denny at least initially said he didn't wheel hop it, but everything I saw looked like he overdrove it, the rear kind of started hopping on him and knocked him loose.
Did you get a chance to watch the media interview with Denny and then later with Tony?
No, I didn't.
Go to my YouTube channel, and I've got both the interviews there. The one with Tony is, oh my God, hilarious. About 45, 50 minutes long. And Denny sat there and said, you know, he said he knew when he moved Tony and he tapped him, he said he was, for the rest of that lap, that was what he was expecting. And he just said, I just knew I was going to get nailed by him. So he was already in a defensive mode as far as...
He had to have known that Tony was going to do anything he could.
Oh, yeah.
It wasn't like, obviously, an insane iRacing dive bomb, but it wasn't going to be, it was going to be pretty much everything, but, you know, I think Tony would have spun him. He didn't care if Denny made it out of that corner, because at the end of the day, Tony's likely in the chase now, and, you know, that's huge, especially in his last year.
Yeah. But onto the next big topic of the weekend, did you check out the truck race?
No, actually I did not, because it was like, when it started late, not that great, and I just pretty much, I watched the highlights of it, and it's hard to watch every race throughout the year, especially when we're at so many of them, you know, like you only get a few days off.
Yeah, so what did you think about the WWE part of the race?
It was a doubleheader, right? Race and wrestling.
Yeah.
Do it
was a fun track, though. I really wish I was out there, but wasn't able to watch it.
So, what'd you think about the thing with Spencer and John?
Oh, that wasn't really a fight. It was kind of like one guy hugging the other one elbowing. But I think maybe that, you know, they definitely meant that. Spencer's not the fighting type.
So yeah.
If you try to fight Spencer Gallagher, I wouldn't expect him to throw a punch back if it saved his life.
I don't think he did.
That's not the kind of guy he is. But John, obviously, I didn't think John West was either. But. Yeah, John was not happy, and it wasn't quite like a fight you'd see in any other sport. I wish he landed a few good punches just so that it made the highlight reels for good things and not bad things.
I was telling these guys here, I was halfway tempted to think that they probably threw that day together at the end there just to get a new highlight reel put together. You know, because it doesn't look like there was really any heavy punches really landed. It looked like just love taps or something like that.
Yeah, well, Spencer was holding John's arms pretty tough, and it looked like he was holding on for his leg. So if John had shaken through, I think he would have thrown a few. But, yeah, Spencer wasn't going to let him. Yeah. It was more of just a big hug.
I was half tempted after the race to text the guys, but I said, I'll stay away for a while.
Yeah, I know it's been a topic heard around the world, so I've just been steer clear of that, but that wasn't what you'd like it to be, that's for sure.
Yeah. So what else is going on in your life now, other than the latest going on that we've already talked about?
Not much. You know, constantly trying to find driving, and I know, like, Pat Benedetto said the same thing, it's like, driving and racing is your life, so you don't really have much going on outside of that, you're just constantly trying to find more and move forward, so excited to go. I mean, I'm literally somewhere in Georgia right now, in a Steak and Shake, pulled over halfway to Daytona. So we'll be in Daytona about 11 o'clock tonight, get some sleep, and hopefully if the weather holds up, go on track tomorrow. You know, just want to make the race this weekend, and if we make the race, I think we got about as good a shot as anybody, just because that's kind of the essence of Daytona. You're able to go out there and compete. But, and then we got Indy coming up in about 3 weeks with DK, so not a big opportunity. Just want to make the race there and learn all I can, because sadly I have two more cup races this year that I'm 100% certain of right now. So just about making laps and learning all I can.
Now, what's your car number going to be this weekend?
Car number 15 for Rickler Racing, sponsored by Science Logic.
Cool. Now, you've been working with Science Logic for quite a while, if I remember correctly.
What was that?
I said you've been sponsored by Science Logic for quite a while, if I remember correctly.
Our first race with them was last November at Phoenix, so it hasn't been too long of a relationship, but obviously, like, it's working out great. They said it was one of the best sales and marketing events they've ever had. So it shows a lot. It says a lot about our industry that a company that you wouldn't think is very congruent or like with or demographic centric in NASCAR is able to go out and say that it's the best sales and marketing event they've ever had. So I'm really excited about that. And obviously, I want to continue growing with Science Logic and find a few more Science Logics for companies like that so we can go out and race a little bit more. But for me to have even a steady sponsor that, you know I can run 3 or 4 races a year is huge because 2 years ago, I didn't know if I was going to ever race again. You know, it's tough without money, but I really wouldn't have anything without them right now.
Yeah. All right, Ryan. Anything, if you ain't got anything else to share with us yet, I reckon we're going to have to let you go.
But now, see, it should be a good omen that we had you on the show this week so that you can go out and win Daytona and come back next week.
That has happened, by the way.
So. Yeah, we would love to do this every week, huh?
Yeah.
Ask us.
Yeah, well, we'll see. Like I said, I think we got a pretty good shot. I mean, honestly, like I say it a lot, but I think this is one of the biggest opportunities in my life. So not only personally, just with a good finish, but to show Science Logic, this is our first step into the Xfinity Series. I think it could prove a lot to them and show them that we can run a little bit better at Xfinity for a little bit less money than you can at Cup. So it's very exciting just to go out there and run with a good car and a good team at Rick Ware Racing and try to run it to the front, obviously. We don't get a lot of shots to do that.
Well, tell Rick that I said hi when you get out there.
I will. Yeah, he's been running around a lot. He's got 3 cars there this weekend. So.
Oh, boy.
I'm sure his head's about to fall off.
All right, Ryan. Well, have good luck. Kick butt. Have fun all the same. And give me a shout.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you very much for having me on, guys.
Thanks.
All right.
Good luck this weekend.
Thank you very much.
All right. Bye-bye.
See you guys.
See ya. Click. There you go. That's the hardest thing. When do you hang up?
So he's Xfinity. He's running Xfinity this time.
This just time he's running Xfinity with Rick Ware, and then he's running BK Racing at Indy.
Right. He's got 3.
But that'll be a Cup race, not an Xfinity race.
Correct.
Yeah. Okay.
So he's going to be
depending
running.
Depending on who asks him for the week or who he's obligated for, certain weeks he'll be in different venues,
yeah.
I guess.
Yeah. Take what you get.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, that's cool.
Because I would say the first race that we ever, or I ever saw him in, was at Richmond. It was a fall race because his fraternity sponsored was on the car. It was an Xfinity race. Because my friend's son came up and was on the pit crew for him.
Wow. Stop it. Well, that's cool.
You're getting weekend voice there, my dear. Get it out there.
Who you got coming on next?
Us.
Was that it?
Yeah, it's only a couple minutes till 8 o'clock.
Well, hey, check this out. So I was reading the JC thing, and I guess the International Speedway Corporation they're looking at Richmond and Phoenix to do similar projects with Daytona Rising. So those are the two tracks they're looking at for big improvements next. And the plans are being drawn up, and those are the ones that are next in line to get those type of improvements. So that's kind of interesting to think about what they might do with Richmond. Hmm. Stadium type racing is what they're trying to create. So whether that means they do leave maybe the front stretch like it is and then do an upper deck, who knows what it would look like design. But I mean, it's that whole stadium idea plus the upgrades that they did with IT and all that, and
they got some pretty neat stuff up there already.
Amenities for the fans and all that kind of stuff. So yeah, I mean they've been changing that track.
Yeah,
for a while over the past 4 or 5 years, they've made a lot of changes already. But I don't know if that means they're going to bulldoze what they already did and try to make a mirror track of Daytona only at a smaller scale.
Well, they took down that the backs, the seating.
Yeah. I don't know if that's part of the plan or because they want to fill up what seats they,
just
eliminate that so they can kind of have more of something that looks like a sellout.
What's
that?
They're going to do a Darlington, make the back stretch and the front stretch?
Yeah, well, I don't know. That's what I don't know.
Yeah, but what's the club that's up on the level?
The Torque Club?
The Torque Club. Have you been up there?
No, I haven't.
That's very nice. I've been to a few parties and special events there, taking photos. Mm-hmm. very nice.
Yeah, and that's in a good position on the track where
when you go there,
you can see the whole thing.
You've got several bars. Of course, you've got like wall-to-wall TVs.
Yeah.
And you've got like other areas. So if you're with a group, you can kind of like separate yourself, mm-hmm. or you can still be part of a group. You can stay inside with all the amenities, but it also has its own balcony so you mm-hmm. can walk out or go and take the elevator to the top. Mm-hmm. And I mean, you can see downtown Richmond. You see, you know, a lot of other zip codes when you're up in the very mm-hmm. top there.
And I guess the idea would maybe to draw more people to the race. Again, even if you don't know anything about the race itself, you come for the event. You're hanging around and, you know,
yeah,
you're taking part in like those same type of facilities like you may have at an NFL football game. You got bar areas and you got restaurant areas and shops and all that stuff along with the race itself.
Yeah, but you know, I miss all the haulers. We would go from hauler to hauler. I mean, granted that big tent thing is nice, but...
I've yet to go in the big tent thing.
I mean, it was nice how it was laid out, but it's like... You missed it, because some of the haulers, you could get special deals, or the drivers would be there, or...
And some of the people you actually could create relationships with.
Exactly.
And so now, most all those people that I used to know are no longer there.
Yeah, they're all gone.
I haven't even checked with my buddy at Wiley X if he's part of that, or if he's still a separate entity out there.
Well, they don't have any haulers anymore.
Well, Wiley X was never a hauler.
Yeah, but all the sales now are in that... tent, that booth.
They still have some kiosks though, like for the food.
Yeah, because that's what Wiley X was using, 10x10.
Stuff like that.
Yeah, but they did away with, when I was there, they did away with those. Only ones that were 10x10s now were food. Not to say that it can't be there, but obviously.
Yeah. Well, we'll find out next time we're there. Anyway, anything else to throw out there? I know your new hero is John West Hanley now, right, Colin? Mm-hmm.
No, that's
Tony Stewart's here, not.
Anywho,
I
don't know
what.
Are we gonna take bets on Daytona? Daytona can
you
say retired?
It'll be a Toyota.
Oh yeah, for sure.
So pick one, because I mean the last race it was Denny Hamlin. Once one of those cars is out front, you know nobody's catching up to him. So you can
go
say
Tony
Truex. You could say Denny Hamlin or
Kenseth.
You may as well say one of those three will walk away with the trophy.
Will there be a big one in
Hamlin? Remember Austin Dillon's wreck last year? Got up in the fence.
Oh yeah, towards the end. Yeah,
towards the end, got up in the fence, came back down.
Yeah, that's true.
And that was last year. So I wonder if we'll see anything big and exciting.
How much rain interruption will we have? Will they get the race finished before 2 a.m?
Or will we just run it Monday?
Well, Saturday here, we're at a 60% chance of rain.
Yeah, and Florida, I mean, that's just a given. Mm-hmm. This time of year, it's going to be rain at some point.
Could be having the
hurricanes.
But this is a night race, though. Scheduled as a, what, 7:30 start, something like that?
Yeah,
so if rain is screwing things up, then it may really be late.
All right, we're ready to shut the shindig down.
May as well. Unless John West Stanley wants to call in and...
I have Spencer's number. I lost John West's number. I'm pissed. I got Spencer's. But I would maybe call Al, but yeah, then we'll really start running late then. It'd be good for a half hour. Anywho, everybody, we're going to catch y'all back next week on Let's Talk Racing. Well, you'll see those smiling faces that you're looking at right now. Ha ha ha. See ya.